I am so glad that we are done fasting. But look what happened. The last two Sunday services, the worship is just gone to a new place. So I'm excited about that. That is exactly why we do these things. We exercise these disciplines so that we can get more in tune with the Holy Spirit, what He wants for us. And so don't be surprised if we don't, call you back to fasting sometime soon. Hey, okay. Y'all, I'm just going to, you just stay there, but we're going to put some people around Judah to pray for him. Judah's taken off on Thursday, and he's going to be gone for too long. You know, just like Nolan goes away sometimes, he was gone for too long just recently, but he's going to be away for 6 weeks. So actually, we should probably lay hands on Sam. Yeah. And come on, I want some of my leaders over there. Hallelujah. Father, Lord, we're a free nation because of families like this. Families that sacrifice time and togetherness. And I pray, Lord, that you would bless both Judah and Sam and Liliana. And in this separation, you would make it as if they're not. That you would comfort each of them. You would keep them. And Lord, I thank you that they can communicate during this time. It's just training time, but nonetheless, it's going to be 6 weeks, six long weeks, and I pray you'll cover them and keep them. And we'll give Sam grace, being with the baby all alone without her husband. And just give her a special portion of your presence and watch over them and keep them. And Lord, let her have absolutely no fears while her husband's gone. That your presence would be there on the property, around the house. Everywhere they go, she would sense you with her, strengthening her, blessing her. That this it would be a very unusual season of comfort and presence. Father, I thank you for watching over them, giving Judah traveling safety. And that as he goes, he would go as your voice. He would go as a representative of your kingdom. As in times past when he's gone, there have been lives that have been changed eternally. We pray that anointing would be released again, that he would be a mouthpiece for your kingdom, and you would cause him just to have a boldness to lead others to a point where they bow their knees and they confess with their tongues that Jesus, you are Lord. We thank you for covering him, giving him special friendships while he's there, and making the time go quickly. Lord, we look for fruit out of this sacrifice. We bless them to that end in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Uh-oh. What'd you do? You pinched her? Nolan pinched her. You know, one of the greatest things I love about church, and especially this church, is the sense of family and togetherness. And you know, we're in this together. Doesn't matter what comes our way. We're in it together. And that's why I'm, you know, in this message series on up. Because we need to go to new heights, new depths, new levels. We need to have greater experiences. Amen? And we need to understand that just like in the movie Up, right? There's things that will tend to distract you and take you here and there, you know, you can get caught up in the moment, or you like Doug. Love, you gotta love that little dog, Doug. Squirrel! And you need to plan for squirrel in your life. Because if you don't plan for it, you'll just keep squirreling. But you have to have a way to get back on track, amen? And so, we're here, you know, to equip you. That's the job of the church. That's my job, is to equip you. So we're here to resource you. Over the last couple of weeks, we did commitment cards. We still have some of those. If you weren't here, you would take two of those. You'd mark one thing. We talked about it takes 18 to 254 days to set a habit, to change a habit, depending on the complexity of the habit. Some habits can be created in as little as 18 days. We've all heard the myth it's 21, but it's actually 18 to 254 by the studies. So we need in this season to commit to doing new things. Right? We got to do something different than we are now. Otherwise, just call me crazy. Right? Just can't keep doing the same things and expecting different results. You got to up your game. Right? Moment of silence for our team. Because they didn't up their game. They had some missing pieces. I mean, they are such a picture of the church. But when you lose your Earl Thomas, when you lose your Lockett, when you lose, you know, Ifedi on the front line, when you lose key players, look what happens. So true with the church. And this is why we do things like this. We do, and you know, we resource. I mean, I've got all these Bible reading plans. You can read your Bible in a year. I got a one-year plan back there. We've got a six-month plan back there. I got a 30-day plan. 3-month plan. Thank you. I'm on a 30-day plan for the New Testament. So, not everybody can do that. But I am just craving to know the Word more. And the more I read, the more I want to read. Amen. I mean, it's kind of like, I don't know about you, but you know when you're thirsty and you're kind of dehydrated and you have some water? What do you want? More water. And then when you finally get satiated, you're filled with water, what do you still want? More water. It's the craziest thing. So we're in this message series. We also have, if you weren't here, how many weren't here to receive the wristbands? Let's get those wristbands flying. All right, Ray, I'm putting you on the spot back there. And Tony and Holly's going to help you. I don't know where they're at, but we got wristbands to help you because you know, you can only put so much on these, but we got our motto, word up, pray up, speak up, and reset church on there. So if you didn't get one, uh-oh, they must have went to the office. Okay, well, they'll be back. I'll move on. Just as a reminder, right, this is where we're going, this message, spirit, soul, and body, we got to do these things. There's some certain things that we have to do. I mean, we can't just sit in our lounge chair sipping umbrella drinks and expect God to take everything for us. Amen. And I got this section going. Maybe we can get a wave going, right?
Amen.
I will touch in on some of these and we'll get there someday. And all of this is so that we can grow up into Him. Because really our goal, our whole life's mission should be to be like Jesus. The best representation that we can possibly be. To live like Him. To love like Him. And to do it? I think some of you got it. Now. Don't wait. Don't wait till tomorrow to be more like Jesus. If you think, oh, I'll just, you know, tomorrow, I'll start tomorrow. How many people have ever met tomorrow? The only day I have ever met or ever lived in is today. Tomorrow is always out there. Tomorrow, tomorrow, right? Come on, we can sing and sing and sing, but all we have is today. What are you going to do today? Today you can go out of this place and be like Jesus. All right, if you didn't get a band, put your hand in the air. Yeah, come on. You missed it. You blinked. See it? Listen, there's certain things that we need to begin to do as a church. To be the church. To be Jesus in our world. I'm gonna try and talk the team into letting me put up an equation on the wall. We'll see how far that goes. You know, Einstein had an equation, right? Everybody knows his equation? E equals MC squared. and it kind of unlocked the secrets of the universe? Well, I have an equation for unlocking the secrets of our universe and the kingdom of God in our city, and that would be M equals E cubed. Mission being the M. Our mission. We need to be missional about everything we do. We need to be doing life with purpose, on purpose. We've got a mission. You're not here. You're not just sucking oxygen and paying taxes just for nothing. You exist for a reason. We all have a mission in life, things to accomplish. So our mission is to engage, right? Equip and empower. That's the E cubed. E to the third power, right? So that's the equation. Maybe we'll see it if I get permission. M equals E cubed. Engage, equip, and empower. We talked last week about Matthew 28, right? Matthew 28, the Great Commission. Jesus spoke to them saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Right? So does that just about cover it? All authority over everything. Heaven, earth, right? And so he said, because, and if we could get some different translations going here, what he's really saying is, because I have authority over everything, I am sending you in that authority to go into all the world to make disciples. Baptizing people, teaching them, leading them into the fullness that I have for them. And I'm with you always. This is the thing that this is probably the first thing we forget in our world. God is with us. No matter what, even if there's a storm in life. You don't even want to begin to hear about all the storms we've gone through, because it would be too depressing. Cancer. The death of a baby. Right? Financial. You name it. It's horrible. But you know, Jesus has been there with us through it all. And for us, during times of crisis is when actually we sense more of the presence of God. For whatever reason, I guess because we're more sensitive and desperate, whatever it is. Listen, we are supposed to go into all the world. We're supposed to go cross-culturally. And I kind of ended on the note talking about it, that we've got to quit judging people based on appearance. Whether they're Christians or the world, it doesn't matter. And I gave you the illustration of Joseph. Joseph, right, was in Egypt. And I'm telling you, he looked like an Egyptian. I'm sure he had the eye makeup, everything, the garb, all of that stuff going. It was so much so, he looked and talked like an Egyptian. Well, like, you know, an Egyptian. His brothers didn't even know him. His brothers didn't even know him. Now, granted, there was a time of separation, but still, you know, I would think that even though I have not seen my older brother for how many years? A lot of years. Probably about the same number of years as Joseph didn't see his brothers. But I would know my brother. I would know him. These guys didn't recognize their own brother. So that tells me that he looked a lot like an Egyptian. My point is, Joseph didn't compromise anything. And so just because somebody has a few body piercings or more than a couple of tats, right? Body art, they call it now. Doesn't make them any less Christian. I mean, why are we always so hung up on the way people look? Let's just get to the heart. God looks at the heart. Aren't you so thankful that God just goes to the heart? Looks at your heart? God is for us, not against us. So we need to have more of that going in our lives. He's always with us. And we need just to live like Him. You know, you're the apple of God's eye. Do you know what that means? If you want to study that out in the Old Testament, the passage that is contained in, the Hebrew language actually says you're the pupil that He looks through. So God's looking at the world through you. You're so special, and I want to talk a little bit about that today as we move on in this series, Up, Going Up. We need to go to a greater place in our lives. In Matthew 5, 13 through 16, it says, You. You ought to point at you. Do it with all fingers, eh? You are the salt of the earth. Now, that's an interesting phrase, an interesting saying. And for us, it's kind of like, okay, all right, we're the salt of the earth. And, you know, we can conjecture on what it's talking about. But in ancient times, in times of antiquities, the cultures that had salt, not all cultures had salt, they used salt as a means for commerce. It became money. That was their money, if you can imagine. Your money being salt was a method of trade and currency for them. That's what it was. In fact, the word salad, kind of strange, little interesting factoid, if you will, originated from that word salt because it began with the early Romans would salt their leafy greens and their vegetables. And so from that came that word salad, out of the word salt. That's what they did. Now we understand salt's used as a metaphor in the Bible, but here's what Jesus is really trying to drive to. He's trying to in the terms of their culture because, see, they understood their culture that salt was valuable, just like money. You know, it's like having a Benjamin in your pocket. Everybody loves to have a Benjamin. You know what I'm talking about, right? $100 bill. Who doesn't like to have $100 bill in your pocket? Or a couple of them, right? It's even better if there's a couple of them in there, keeping them company, keeping each other company. In fact, a threefold cord is the best. Three Benjamins together. Can't think of anything better. Just walk around, just have that. Anyway, so they understood this metaphor of salt was speaking to value, and Jesus is trying to speak to his followers and those disciples about their value. You need to hear this. This goes right to the idea of value. You've heard the phrase, he's not worth his salt. How many have heard that phrase? Not worth his salt, or he's worth his salt. This is where this originates from, out of this concept. Because the salt used to be used in that time to trade slaves in ancient Greece. So if you wanted to buy a slave, you just provided salt to the slave trader because that was the currency of the time. The value of a human measured in salt. You are the salt of the earth, Jesus is saying, right? Another interesting fact is that the Roman soldiers often were given salt rations, and it was called solarium argentum, which became the forerunner for today's word, salary. Salary, not celery. Salary. Somebody went, oh, I didn't, salary, money. Listen, Jesus is trying to get across this point, and he's backing up, and later on he's going to come back to this concept and try and instill it another way, because we miss these things that Jesus is trying to put into us so often. He's trying to tell you, you are valuable. You are worth your salt. And he comes in Matthew chapter 10, you'll recognize, right? And he's talking about birds and hair. He says, God knows the number, the very number of hairs on your head. Whether it's zero or a multitude. He knows it all. And then he asks him, he talks about God providing everything. And then he talks about if a single sparrow falls from the sky, God knows about it. Do you know how many birds there are in the world? certainly a lot more birds than there are humans. And a single sparrow falls to the ground, God knows about it. And then Jesus says, don't you get it? Don't you know that you're more valuable than a sparrow? What does this mean to us? You know, if you don't see yourself as valuable, you won't live valuable. If you see yourself as being of little or no value, then you're going to represent that in your life and through your life as a person who just isn't making it. And God is trying to confront this thinking, this mentality. I don't get it. We are His children. We're His kids. He will go to any length to provide what we need as we're doing things the way He wants us to do. Just like we as parents do for our kids. All of you that have kids in here, think about this for a moment. As they're growing up, even as they're grown up, do you really require them to do certain things so that you will love them? No. You just love them. You love them with your whole heart. Now there are times where it's like, oh, why are they doing that? And you don't love what they do. But you don't stop. You don't ever stop loving them. See, it's no different with our Heavenly Father. Because He values you. He looks at the world through you. He sees you differently than you see yourself. He sees your greatness. He sees the value. He says you are the salt of the earth. But if you don't think that you have value, then you're going to constantly qualify this. If the salt loses its flavor. Right? Salt without flavor is valueless. In fact, he says, it's good for nothing but to be cast out. And, you know, make it part of the road. Walk on it. That's what they would do. You are of great value. You need to see yourself as valuable. You need to understand that from God's perspective, that we need to challenge ourselves. Because, you know, the very first person that puts God in a box? It's right here. It's you and I. Because we forget these truths. We forget that He loves us so much. And that if it's within His power to do something for us, He is going to do it. Now, is there anything that's outside of His power? See, with us, with men, things can be impossible. But for God, nothing is impossible. Nothing. God goes on. And here's what God sees you as and what He says you are. You are the light of the world. Wait a minute, I thought Jesus was the light of the world. Yeah, He says He is later on. But before He claimed to be light of the world, He said, you are the light of the world. He threw that on you and I first. Before He came along later on and said, I am the light of the world. You are the light of the world. Come on. And then He backs it up with an illustration. This is what He's doing. He's telling you metaphorically that you should be just like a city that's on a hillside. And at night, you are seen. People know which direction to go because they can see you. Do people know which direction to go? After they've come in to an encounter with you? Right? I would suggest you try this one out. Has anybody told you where to go today? Now, you know how where the world would take that. But where your pastor would take that is go to heaven. Just go to heaven. Do everything you can to make sure you go to heaven. Right? Flip it on them. A city that's set on a hill cannot be hidden. No, you don't take a lamp and put it under a basket. No, when you light a lamp and you put it out there, a candle in your room, you put it out for all to see so that all can have light so that you can do whatever it is that you need to get done. John 8:12 said, Jesus was speaking to the people at that time. He said, I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life. That's what we're here for, is to receive that light of life, that we would have that same life within us. John 12:36, he says, while you have the light, believe in the light. He's saying, listen, you need to believe in me so that you may become sons of the light. John 12:36, you become sons and daughters of the light. Philippians 2:15 tells us that we're supposed to be blameless and pure, children of God, without fault in a crooked and perverse generation. Boy, I haven't seen a more crooked and perverse generation than the one we're living in now. Amen. And he says, in which you shine as lights in the world. I love the fact that we just had a full moon. How many saw the full moon? Right? It was pretty bright, wasn't it? You understand that the moon has no light of its own. And yet it was up there. I mean, it was as bright as day is against night. Right? I mean, it just, boom, there it is. Even during the day, the other day, it was so bright you could see it. You could see all the little, you know, the whatever you, craters and shadows. Yeah. The little alien that was eating the cheese. Not quite. But the moon doesn't create any light of its own. But you see, this is exactly the illustration that we should become. We should be like the moon. We're in the presence of the Son of God, where His glory and His light is coming on us and filling us. And then we reflect, we become the largest, the world's largest reflector known. And all of us together reflecting the light of Jesus Christ into a dark world. We're just like that moon in orbit around the earth, all around the world, wherever we go, we're just reflecting what Jesus has done for us. His light, His goodness, His mercy. I love what the Spirit was trying to say to somebody today. That you're living law, 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 law. You're allowing the enemy to beat you down with the law. You're allowing him to tell you what's right and wrong and give you a list of do's and don'ts. When Jesus came, the Bible clearly says he came in mercy and truth. His mercy is grace and love and forgiveness. Long-suffering, compassion, all of those good things that we know, that is His mercy and truth. And the truth is there so that we don't continue to do the things that the enemy is trying to put the law on us for. Just like the woman caught in adultery, he did not beat her up. He didn't say, oh, you are just, oh, so filthy, vile, horrible. No. He just said, go and sin no more. So the next time you're challenged in your value, you're challenged in your experience, you need to be looking to the mercy side, not the law. We're all guilty before God, but the blood of Jesus has cleansed us. He's made us to be the righteousness of God in Christ. We need to reflect that. And that's what he comes back in verse 16. He says, let your light so shine before men that they see your good works. You see, we're supposed to be doing something about this. Brothers and sisters, listen. Good works is more than just showing up on Sunday morning. If that's all we're doing in our Christian existence, we need to challenge ourselves to go up. We need to do something more. We need to get involved somehow. So that people can see the goodness of God in us and through us. We got to get out of our comfort zone. We got to get outside of these four walls. We need to fulfill the Great Commission and go into all the world. I have to give you this because I am going to stretch and pull some of you out of your religious comfort areas, because there are people who would put a description on what it means to be a Christian. And I just got to say, the Word of God says the kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Ghost. The kingdom is not meat or drink. It's not about the external. It's about what's going on in here. And so if you see somebody doing something, well, I don't approve of that. Really? You who judge. Oh my, now I'm meddling. Why don't you take the log out of your own eye before you start looking at the speck in somebody else's? Come on, the easiest thing to pick on from the Bible perspective in culture today. I mean, back in my day, my pastor, my very first pastor, Brother Dick Iverson, you know, he wasn't allowed to go to the movie theater. If you went to the movie theater, you were going to hell. Well, I tell you, I've been there too many times then. I am condemned. Is there anything wrong with a movie theater? No. 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 You see, it's not about how you wear your hair. It's not about the clothes, the style, keeping your... There were churches, trust me, there were churches that used to have, what do they call them, yardsticks, rulers, glued or taped or nailed in the, what do you call that? When you come in the doorway, right? The door jamb. And they had people that watched. And if your, ladies, if your dress was above a certain mark on that, they would say, you can't come in here. Holiness is not about the absence of jewelry or makeup. Or the way you wear your hair. Holiness is about your personal relationship with Jesus Christ. All right, I got to move on. Hi. Let your light... Listen, you need to decide. And it doesn't matter. There's no judgment zone. If you're a birthday candle, be the best birthday candle you can be. Let your light shine as a birthday candle. Or if you're a tiki torch, right? It's all right. You know, you're burning a little brighter. Or maybe you're a lighthouse. You're out there and, you know, you're seen for miles. Here's the deal. Whatever it is, we're supposed to be a perpetual bonfire. I love that word bonfire because bon is the word good in French. So when we have a bonfire, we're having a good fire. And that's what Christians are supposed to be, is a good fire. A fire that warms the hearts of others. A fire that's attractional. A fire that draws people in. You know, when you're out on the beach, it's like there's just, if people are having a good time on the beach and there's a bonfire, well, at least it used to be back in the day when we would go, the bonfire was an invitation for everybody to come. You just could come. It didn't matter if you didn't know anybody there. You got to know them. Because it was a good fire. It was an invitation. And that's what we're supposed to be with us. We're supposed to be the light of the world. Attracting people to what we have. Helping them to say, I want to be. So we need to be that perpetual fire. We need to be like that bush that Moses encountered. Right? It burned but wasn't consumed. The secret of a good perpetual bonfire is fuel. You know what that look was. The size of the flame is proportional to the amount of fuel. And what are you filling yourself with? What are you fueling yourself with? Let me go into overdrive. We need to be the influence God's called us to be. We've got to up it in the spirit. And listen, to light our fire, obviously you got to be born again. You got to be saved. And then you've got to be fueled or filled. You need to be fueled with the Word and the Spirit. Those are the two primary things. If I can get you to become addicted to the Word and the Spirit, then I will have accomplished my mission on earth. Because your fire will just perpetually grow. The more fuel, the more Word you put into your life, the more Spirit. Listen, there's going to come a time where there's going to be 10 virgins, 5 wise, 5 foolish. What was the difference? The difference was the fuel in their life. Be wise. Get some fuel. Listen, we don't live by bread alone. We don't live in the natural realm alone, but we live by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. What is this saying? We live in a dynamic, interactive, personal relationship with Almighty God. And in the 3 minutes I have, I'll try and give you 5 reasons we need the Word. The Word is eternal. Jesus told us this. This Word that He has granted to us will not pass away. Not one dot, not one tittle, not any part of it is going to pass away. It'll all be fulfilled. Listen, Psalm 119:89 says, "Forever, O Lord, Your word is settled in heaven." Now, in this world, too many things are transitory. Too many things come and go, and they're just not stable. The Word of God is stable. It does not change. It is a rock that you can build on. That's why Jesus gave us the parable of the builder. We need to understand He's talking to us again. He's saying, in your life, you have the opportunity to build something of consequence, something that people will recognize as something that is worthy. Now, are you going to build on sand or are you going to build on the rock? Because it doesn't matter where you build, the storms will come. The rain is going to come down. The floods will come. The winds will come. And it doesn't matter who you are. You see, because it rains on the just and the unjust. Don't let anybody sell you a Christianity that's all goosebumps. Sometimes bad things happen to good people because we have a real enemy that's out to destroy us. We are in a war, but we don't want to admit it. The rains will come. What are you going to build on? Jesus said, those that built on the rock will last. And those that build on the sand is the philosophies of humanism. The world's ways. The Word is eternal. The Word brings stability. The Word brings life. Jesus said this. The words I speak to you are spirit and they are life. Amen. Peter said, "We're not going anywhere. We're staying with you." John 8, verse 31 and 32, bonus scripture. John 8, 31 to 32. If you abide in my word, abide is like make your home, make your house, dwell there. Be in my word, word up in my word. Then you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. You get it? Word. Word brings truth. Jesus comes to us in mercy and truth. When we get the word, we get the truth. And we have truth, we get freedom. Do I need my blue paint? Do a little William Wallace on you, right? Freedom! Truth shall make you free. You need to understand God loves you. People may not. They're going to mistreat you. They're going to do horrible things. And just because the world around you mistreats you doesn't mean that God doesn't love you. We got to grow up. We got to believe more. See, the word from God's mouth accomplishes things. Isaiah 55, 11, you know this one. I've hammered on this one. So shall be my word that goes forth from my mouth. It shall not return to me void, but it shall accomplish what I please, and it shall prosper in the thing for which I sent it. When you get God's word activated in your life and it becomes a part of you and God gives you a word, that word goes to work. But it does amazing things. It accomplishes things. Listen, it's the word that sustains our faith. I'd have to say, we need more faith in the church. And faith comes from hearing. You see, hearing comes from the word. Do you know the easiest way to find out if you're going to be successful in evangelism and talking to somebody about Jesus? Is to ask them one question first. What do you think about the stories of the Old Testament? You see, because Jesus told us in the New Testament, if they don't listen to the law and the prophets, if they won't hear Moses, they're not going to be convinced even if they see somebody raised from the dead. So you want a shortcut? You want a quick, hey, is this going to be a fruitful fishing trip? Ask them their perspective, what they think about the Bible. You see, because if they go, oh yeah, yeah, you know, I get it, that's God's word, and it's a good thing. Then you need to fish on. Throw some more bait at them. Start telling them about, well, what? How is it active in your life? Then you can engage them. Word sustains our faith. Listen, Hebrews 4:2 says, the word which they heard, here it is again. You got to hear it. You got to understand it. You got to operate it. You got to grab a hold of it. It says, the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. And so you can hear the word, but if you don't mix faith in there, you just put God in a box. You just shortchanged the word of God. You just unplugged the power that God wants to release in your reality by not mixing with. Listen, here we have all these stories, and I could go on and on and on so much. And this is the benefit of reading your Bible a lot. Amen. It just jumps in there. Abraham, now come on, 90 years old, and you get a visit. Hey, Kenyon, you're 90. He's not 90 yet. But his reaction, I know what his reaction would be. 90 years, hey, you're going to have a kid. In fact, Abram, I'm going to change your name to Abraham. See, we always call him Abraham, but his name was really Abram. And the first thing that God does in your life is he calls those things that are not as if they are. Abram was a fatherless man, and he said, look, I'm going to call you Abraham. I'm going to call you a father of a multitude. You see, he started speaking into his destiny. And we go, oh, that's that name it and claim it stuff. That's judgmental. You got to stop that. It's just Bible. So Abraham, knowing the deadness of Sarah's womb, believed God. And it was accounted unto him for righteousness. And they had a baby. When he was 100. So if it was really, if it was impossible at 90, at 100 years old, I'm just saying, we have to mix the word with faith. We've got to quit just saying, well, I didn't see it, so it can't be real. It didn't happen for me. I tried tithing 1 week. Really? Come on, Yoda up. Do or do not. There is no try. You see, you don't get results until you commit. My body is not going to be like, you know, Mr. Universe if I just say I have a gym membership. It's my problem. I have a gym membership. I've got to mix some faith. I've got to put some works into my actions. I got to do something about it. We have to hang on to it. We have to go for it. Because the Word is alive. It's power-filled and it's interactive. It affects us from the inside out. But you got to get it in for it to come out. But if you're looking for some results in your life, reprogram this thing. Start living in the Word, jumping into it. We get it. The Word of God is living and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit. What's really of the mind, will, and emotions, and what's of the spirit. It's a discerner of the thoughts and the intents. Listen, we need to set the Word free in us so that the Word becomes a lamp to our feet and a light to our path. This is what we need to do. We need a word revival. We need to read it. We need to speak it. And we need to pray it. Amen. Stand with me. I'll stop there. Listen, I say these things because I love you and I want the best for you. I want you to experience everything that God has for you. Miracles. Jesus told us we would do the same things he did and even greater because he is going to the Father. Well, he's with the Father. And I'm ready for greater. I'm hoping and believing and confessing and praying for greater for you, for me, for this church, for our community, for our nation. We need to see Jesus rise up in our generation now. We need to see our loved ones, our friends, our families come to know the grace, the mercy that we've received, the forgiveness of sins. Now, if you're here, man, if there's a shred of heaviness in your heart right now, at all, if you're like, oh, man, that sounds so good. That sounded like a cool drink of water on a 120-degree Mojave Desert day. Well, I would say that's the Holy Spirit pointing out to you that you need more of Him, that you need to up some things in your life, up the Jesus factor in your life. But if you're here, let's go ahead and just bow every head. Give me a moment of privacy with everybody here today. If you're here and you say, Pastor, I need that living water. I need Jesus to refresh me today like never before. And you can just lift your hand so I know who I'm praying for today. Oh, thank you, Lord. Anybody else? Holy Spirit, you have certainly had your way in our midst today. And I ask right now for those who are quick to respond that you would come to their side, you come to their aid. Holy Spirit, fill them right now with refreshing, with a release. That very thing that they're thinking about, I pray that you by your word would come in and cut it off like an axe to the root of a tree. Lord, that you would bring refreshing, you would bring the comfort of God to them. Encouragement and strength would be their portion. Father, bless us this week as we go our ways. Help us to be the light of the world. Help us to know that we are the salt of the earth, that we have value before you, and that we can attract other people because of who we are in you. That as the moon reflects your great light, so can we reflect your glory. And I ask you, you do this for each and every one here today. For I pray and believe in the name of Jesus. And all the receivers said, amen. God bless you. Come on, grab somebody and bring them in next week, because we need more of this.